Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I welcome you all in the virtual second edition of Orange City Literature Fest, organized by SGR Knowledge Foundation. I am Aditi Mishra, your anchor for this session. This session is of 40 minutes, and at the end of the session, there will be a buzzer. And the topic for this session is Women Breaking New Grounds from ISRO to Unsung Heroes. I am very pleasured to welcome the speaker of this session, Madam Minnie Webb. Ma'am has juggled multiple roles over a three-decade stint in mainstream media. She is a print and television journalist, a documentary filmmaker, creative producer for future films, and more recently, author of three non-fiction books, A Doctor to Defend, the Biank Sain story, Iron Arrow, Two Journeys, and The Ant in the Ear of the Elephant. Her area of interest includes social and political issues in rural India, human rights and environment and gender. We welcome you, ma'am. I shall also introduce the moderator for the session, Geeta Rao, ma'am. Ma'am is textile designer and a mother of two, a humanist and a believer in spiritualism at the same time. She is a keen observer and life skill speaker. She lives life with passion and compassion. We welcome you, ma'am, and I would like to hand over the session over to you.
Thank you so much, Aditi.
Thank you.
It's a great experience and a fabulous opportunity to be here on this platform along with Minnie Webb. Yes, I say
Thank
that.
You. Thank you.
I say that with all my sincere best wishes for her, because I've gone through her work since the time I came to know that, yes, I will be moderating her work. I was inclined on reading more and more about her. And the more I read, the more I felt that, yes, I am actually going to talk to a person who, if I'm not wrong, is a feminist, is a person with so much passion for life, so much passion for humanism, and absolute compassion for everybody in the society, and more so over the women. The topic today, which was given to us, was women breaking new grounds from ISRO to unsung heroes. The moment one reads this, there is a sort of energy flow which runs right from your head to toe, where again, you know, there comes a hammer telling you that, yes, it's a male dominated society. And here the women do something, and look, here you are. That women break new grounds. And that confidence has doubled in me when I read Minnie's work. She has.
Thank you. That's so nice.
That has actually, Minnie, because in your book, the preface, the very opening sentence which we read the moment you turn the book is that there is no problem in science that can be solved by a man, and that cannot be solved by a woman.
Cannot be solved by a woman. Yes, absolutely.
How I'm wishing that we absolutely should have been in an open audience filled.
I know.
Uploaded on your expression.
Uploaded, absolutely. Uploaded. That's true. That's
but
true.
But nevertheless, I'm only hoping that our listeners will certainly have a great takeaway from this chat with you. To begin with, I would just like to start with your book regarding the ISRO women, the Mangalyaan women. In late 2013, ISRO launched Mangalyaan, India's first interplanetary mission. This mission was spearheaded by most talented, dedicated and badass group of women scientists, Nandini Harinath, Ritu Karidhal, Momita Datta, and many other Wonder Women who were instrumental in ISRO's other path-breaking work. These magnificent women and their flying machine narrates their inspiring stories, which are actually worked upon by many in such humble and compassionate manner that I just cannot stop myself from asking Mini to tell us about the genesis of this book, which is titled Those Magnificent Women and Their Flying Machines, as to what sparked your interest, or rather what sparked your interest into this particular topic, so scientific and so technical.
Okay, so first of all, thank you very much for such a generous introduction, both Aditi and Geeta. And actually, it's fortuitous that the book, the title of the book actually perfectly matched the women. So I don't know which came first, the title or the book, the women, because there is no other way that I could have described these women other than magnificent. They really were. But it's very interesting how it came about, because I, like everybody, just watched the success at Mangalyaan in 2014. Like an ordinary viewer, I didn't know much about the women. In fact, I knew nothing about the women because the women were not featured that time on TV or anything. There's nothing. Nobody knew anything. And so 2 years went by. And all I remember is that there was that very iconic photograph of a lot of women dressed in Kanchiwaram silk saris with gajra in their hair. And they were, high-fiving each other. That photo I remember. That stuck in my head. That how nice. What a wonderful image. Then in 2016, CII, the women's chapter of CII in Bombay, they had a conference, women conference.
Yeah.
And so they invited me to just attend it. And I would have normally said no, because I don't go to corporate events, and it's very, very far in Bombay. Distances, Bombay traffic is very prohibitive. So, I saw over there that the listed speakers were the ISRO women. So I said, okay, this now, it listed Ritu Karithal and Momita Datta, Meenal Sampath. And I said, fine, this I will certainly brave traffic to go. And I went. And then I was sitting in the audience along with the other people. And then I watched, they have for 45 minutes, these women spoke about their role in the Mangalyaan mission, and they had charts to explain and everything. And that entire audience of largely corporate women, mid-level, senior level, some junior level also, everybody and me, they just sat in pin drop silence, just listening to these women talk about their work. And they were so matter of fact about it. They said there's one sentence that one of them said, which I've used in the book, because I went and asked her, Ritu Karizal. And she said, in the day, we used to work in the office and work on the project, Mangalyaan. And then we would go home and take care of the children and their homework and family and everything. Then in the night also, we'd work on the thing. And somewhere, we sent off a rocket to Mars. So I said, okay, the sort of matter-of-factness and very unassuming nature of the way she put it.
Yeah.
And then we also sent a rocket to Mars. I said, okay, there is a larger story here and I want to know what it is. So when it all got over the session, lunch break ke baad, I went and asked the organizers. I said, I would like to meet them. And then she said, yeah, sure. So I went and met them and I said, I think there's a much bigger story here which I would like to tell. So can I write a book on you? So they're such humble women. They said, you want to write a book on us? Why? I said, are you not hearing the applause that you're seeing? You have a fantastic story and I'd like to tell it. So then she said, but you have to go through our PRO. We can't talk to people just like that. So I said, okay, fine. And that started a long process, took about, 4.5 months to get permission. And then once that permission I got, and then I entered ISRO for the first time, from then onwards, it was absolute smooth sailing. The women were just, in a word, magnificent.
Oh, wonderful. Wonderful. What an experience. In fact, we are thankful to you, Mini. Had you not taken that step ahead and gone and spoken to these women and written all about this in your book, normal public would never have come to know as to what it is and how much it actually takes, you know, to be a scientist, a woman.
That's exactly what the purpose of the book was. One, to let people know that, okay, behind the mission, there were these women who played equal and not subordinate, equal roles and very roles in a high position. Almost 40% of women in the project who played, you know, really key positions in mission design, in communications, in rockets, and lots of things. It wasn't only that, it was also that people didn't know what work they did. But for the young students, like Aditi here, so young students wanting to do science and not getting encouraged, you know, being told by your parents or society, science is not for girls, maths is not for girls, you know, why don't you take arts and stuff like that. To break that image, to say that, okay, if you have somebody like Ritu Karidhar, later on became Chandrayaan 2 mission director, which is absolutely fantastic. So, you know, if you see a woman can reach mission director, then, you know, a small girl studying science in a village can also dream of that and become it. So that was really the main idea.
Very encouraging. Very encouraging. In fact, you know, we will include your books and your tips and recommendations in the life skill talks, which we give in colleges, you know. So it will really help them a lot.
Oh, I'll be very happy. I'll be happy to do that, because really there is a big dearth of women in high positions in scientific areas. Even if you look at heads of departments in science in IITs or in Institute of Science or any of the technological institutes, you'll find one or two or three token presence. Then when it comes to awards given to women for science, you know, the Shashi, the Bhatnagar Award.
Bhatnagar.
Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Attack. That also, you know, I think from out of 526, less than 20 were given to women. So, you know, those are the figures. So there is certainly a gender disparity. And so if the role models, visible role models, I didn't only interview the Mangalyaan women, I interviewed a lot of women scientists in ISRO, because I got the chance, and so I said, why not, you know, go and talk to other people. So younger people, then older women who were, you know, like the senior most scientists in ISRO. So I had a whole range. So I interviewed about 21 scientists in ISRO. And so each of them gave me their inputs that, okay, in ISRO, they said that, you know, there is no gender, there's no ceiling. If your work is good, then you get your, you know, like assignments and everything, promotion, everything. And also the fact that you can have 40% women in good positions for the Mangalyaan mission, the fact that you can have Ritu Karidhar as mission director and Vanita as project director for Chandrayaan 2, this itself is, you know, like enough proof that in ISRO, there is, you know, gender is not a factor, but it is a factor in other, you know, sort of, how shall I put it, things that they said, like, you know, all of them thank their husbands and their families and their in-laws, all of them. Yeah. So when a man becomes successful, nobody really asks him, you know, so is your wife responsible for it? The man rarely thanks, if ever.
Yes.
And here these women all regularly, I mentioned it also somewhere in the book, made it a point to say, my in-laws supported, my husband supported, I was allowed to come late home, you know. So it's like, so parallelly in my head, a voice is going, okay, why should you be allowed? You're working on Mars, you know, it's a matter of pride. But that is a conditioning that we have in India from childhood, that, you know, okay, you know, you shouldn't go late, should do this, should that. All the shoulds come into play. So they just broke all the barriers and they so somewhere in things that they said like that, it would come in. But otherwise, as far as their work, as far as their merit and recognition of their work is concerned, there was no gender barrier, none.
Wonderful. It is such a nice thing to know all this. It is such a nice thing, because we actually cannot imagine this unless and until we go into a deep study. We cannot imagine as to what exactly is happening. Well, Mini, would you recommend these this particular book of yours, Those Magnificent Women and Their Flying Machines, to readers who are not actually interested in science? What attraction does this book hold for them? What would you like to
tell? Okay, that's a very nice question, because I myself am not interested in science. Okay, I really wasn't. I gave up science in class 11. I was very happy to give up. I once remember I got 0 on 20 for a physics test, and yeah, it's not in 11th standard. And it's really remarkable. My mother was a maths teacher. My father is a scientist, from Indian Institute of Science. And here is that child, daughter, who has zero interest. And even though, later on, of course, I got such a firing for those low marks that I studied hard. And I got good marks at the end. And so they enrolled me without my knowledge. I had gone for a holiday to Delhi. They enrolled me for medicine. And I came back and said, no, I don't want to do this. You know, how have you put me in medicine? And I took back my registration and went and followed the path that I was supposed to do, which is mass communication, arts, and then mass communication. And because I wanted to be a journalist from class 10. But so the science, whole science thing was a big bogey. I hated it. But this, I think this book is not really a science kind of a book. Yeah, it is the achievements of these women. And of course, the Mangalyaan mission and the science part of that, like how did they send it? And, you know, all of those things I understood properly from the women. And they got used to seeing blank faces, you know. So I would ask them some question, they would answer. So we used a slingshot theory. So blank look on my face, you know, what is a slingshot thing? But then she would explain. There's still blank look. They should explain some more. So, you know, so that part of it took long, but the explanations they gave were also, you know, nice and, you know, detailed and everything. And then when I was writing it, again, I had to be like, so there is one thing, some black hole or something Sita Somasundaram said, so I had to get into black hole. Then from black hole, something Hubble telescope. And so from one to another, it's like peeling an onion. There's so many layers to the story. But finally, I thought, this is at the end of the day, it's a human story. It's a story of these women and what work they do, how they do it, the pressures under which they do. Where all of them were balancing their family, almost all, except for some a research scholar who went to Antarctica for 4 months. She was very young, I think 24 or 25 years old. But other than that, they were all women with families and children, and they also did all of that. So Nandini Harinath, for instance, had her daughter doing the 12th board exams, science board exams, at the same time that the Mars mission was happening. And so they worked it out. So they would both get up together at 4 o'clock, and they interviewed the daughter also. She said, yeah, you know, if mommy wasn't so busy that time, I would have possibly slept. So we used to get up at 4, have our coffee together. Then I would study and she would work on the mission. And so, you know, they kind of juggled everything without making a big fuss about it. The biggest thing learning that I had from these women is, number one, nerves of steel. That to be able to perform tasks in space, which are so finely calibrated, no margin of error. All of them said space is very unforgiving. If you make a mistake, you're finished. The mission is over. You're not going to get another chance. Hang on a second. I'll just action replay. What in our field we say, retake, or, you know, take two and all. There is no take two in space. And so they had to be really, you know, focused and really good at their work. And balance all that, the timeline, deadlines, everything. So I think a lot of their human stories of how they managed to do that and how they managed to cope with sick children. And, you know, like there was young Meenal, for instance, had a small child. Her child was 4 years old and she had to keep traveling to Bangalore because she's the one who makes the sensors in Ahmedabad. And so she said, you know, I would rush there to Bangalore all the time. I think 20 flights in a month. And as soon as the work would be, testing would be over, I would take whatever flight is possible, 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock at night, rush back so that I can be with my kid. So all of these stories added to a very rounded figure of what these women were. They're not just achievers, you know, unrelated to the world outside. So I had a very stereotypical image in my head. You know, I said, "Are they scientists? Women scientists? They'll be nerds. They'll be in a lab. They won't be going out. They won't be socializing. Nothing could be further from the truth. They were all regular women with, you know, children and responsibilities and, you know, lots of things and doing all of it together without being even aware that, okay, this is what they are juggling. All of that. So I think the book is of interest to everybody because these are all normal things, you know, what you do in the house and who does what in your home. Between husband, wife, children, these are all normal things for everybody.
Yes.
So the science bits are actually much less. It's only when it relates to actually what happened at Mangalyaan, that entire 2-year process. That is, you know, the explanations are given. But again, bear in mind, explanations are written by a person who dislikes science. So, you know, I managed to kind of make it really down to earth so that anybody can understand. It's not a scientific book at all. It's a book about the scientists. And it's more gender related, actually.
That's the irony, actually. That's an irony that person who is not into science has taken so much of interest. But now, listening to you, I understand it is there in your genes, you know, with your mother in the field of mathematics and your father as a scientist. It has just come you and you're doing such a wonderful job, such a wonderful job.
Thank you.
You have answered one more question of mine, which I wanted to know that what is the takeaway for the readers from this book of yours? But in case if you want to add a bit more for the students, because there are many students who are, I believe, are listening to us, who are into science streams and who are struggling to get into the working world. They are still students. So how can they really cope? Because in your book, you have mentioned a few cases where scientists have told you as to what arrangements they have made to make their working life easy. Like, what are their support system, you know? So if you can just share, it's going to be helpful.
Yeah, so in the book, actually, absolutely. There's, in fact, in the book, a laundry list of suggestions for, you know, how you can stay on in the career. Like, even those who have children and, you know, like, all of them said that taking a break for maternity does affect your, you know, promotion and your in your ladder, your hierarchy, and all, naturally, because you need to take time off. But now, there are several schemes about, you know, it's called break the break. So you go back into it and then you get a stipend. You get a stipend so that, you know, it kind of supports you for the time that you are not working. So there are lots of schemes, and as I mentioned it in the book. But more than anything, I would say societal conditioning has to break right from the start, from childhood onwards. So you know, why should you say that maths is not for girls? You know, that kind of thing which begins so early. Like Meenal has given example in the book, like she took her son to buy a birthday present for his little 8-year-old. Her son is 8-year-old. Mm-hmm. And she said, we went to the toy shop to buy a present, and the shopkeeper said, the present is for a boy or a girl. So her son was going to buy a Barbie doll, and she said, no, you buy a helicopter and you see how your friend will assemble the helicopter faster than you. So, you know, the conditioning which you start right from the childhood that, okay, science is not for girls and, you know, it's only for boys and stuff like that, that girls should help their parents lay the table, mother lay the table or in the kitchen or whatever. All of these things begin really early and it has a psychological kind of thing. So start from that. And then later on, of course, safe spaces at workspaces. So all of them said that if you have creche and if you have working facilities, if you have representation of women in the committees, that's a very big step towards, you know, gender parity, because it's not only the sexual harassment committees, but all committees, just so that women get a chance to interact with other people. So it's not a mansplaining world where the men go off to their conferences here and there, and women scientists, because they can't leave their husband and children, they can't attend, so they can't join the men's club. These kind of, you know, there's a whole list that I have given in the book of measures which are, so that's actually direct takeaways. And I think the most important takeaway from the book is the visible role models. So when you see Nandini Harinath or a Ritu or a Sita Somsundaram or a Valar Mathi reach such heights, so that I'm actually not even talking about middle class. I'm talking about in the villages, rural India. I'm talking like there. So people see, a lot of these women have come from small town India. not necessarily IITs and IISc, Indian Institute of Science, or not big shot institutes, like they're from regional engineering colleges. And, you know, so going up from there, and so sky, there is no limit. Sky is the limit. It is the message of the book.
Oh, that's wonderful. That's wonderful. So encouraging. In fact, what is coming to my mind right now is, Mini, the time from when you wrote this book and the Mangalyaan also happened, it's almost 5 to 6 years now. And with this fast-changing world, there is quite a lot of change which has come in. So would you suggest anything, like, there was a film actually, Ka and Ki, where, you know,
the gender roles, gender swapping.
So
I saw that.
Would you suggest something like that for the generation, that acceptance of men being home men or house men and women going out to work or something?
I think in India, it's a long way from that happening. It would be great if it does. But I do actually know a couple of friends who have done that in the past and, you know, stayed at home while their wives went out and did some work. But it's going to be a long time coming. If they can just be equal and, you know, kick butt, I think that's good enough. I'd be happy with that. If the men can just share in their thing. But I'll tell you something very interesting is there in the book also. Ritu's husband, for instance, he's again a top level engineer, works for a private firm. And he said that when I go, he comes from Lucknow, I think she's from Kanpur or vice versa. And she said, when I go home, I'm known as Ritu's husband in the whole neighborhood. So I was God, what a secure man and how wonderful to say that.
Yes.
You know, I've never had this kind of a reaction from anybody saying that. And he's very happy with it. He said, yeah, why not? She's doing such good work. And so even my parents and her parents, they're all so proud of her. And I'm known as Ritu's husband. I said, "Arey wah, kya baat hai?" So it happens.
Difficult to believe though, but bola.
Yeah. No, it happened in front of me. Bilkul bola, bilkul bola. And he said, all the time that she was working on Mangalyaan, I was there for the children because she would also travel. And so get up in the morning, drop her off to the airport and then, you know, take care of the kids. Her kids were also small. Even when I had them, the daughter was only six or seven years old.
Wonderful.
And she was also, I asked her also, I said, you know, did you ever feel bad that mama's not here? No, papa was here, bhaiya was here. So I think all of it kind of, you know, gelled very nicely.
Yeah.
And that's why I went and met the families. I didn't want it to be only a book about the science. And I talked to Nandini's daughters and they said, I said, you know, do you go to see Interstellar or Gravity at all? Do you take mama with you? They said, no, we don't take. She's always cribbing. Aisa kuch nahi hota hai. What are you seeing? So I got a different glimpse into their lives.
Yeah. In fact, that has added more substance to your book. It gives quite a lot of motivation to people who actually want to get into STEM and similar
that's
fields.
That's the point.
You know?
Yeah.
So it's really good. It's really good.
Yeah, that's the whole point. That's the whole point.
I know. In fact, in the book, there is a concept where I'm not remembering the name of the scientist there, but it is written by you that their children did not tell that their mother is working on Mars. Until she was invited for a parent-teacher meet.
Nandini's younger daughter, yes.
So that was
They were working at a very crucial time with the, I think it was the Mars insertion, yeah. And she, it went on to 3 o'clock in the night. And Nandini, also being a parent, knew that she had a morning parent-teacher PTA meeting. And so she called up her child and said, just shift the meeting to the afternoon instead of the morning. So she said, okay. So she went to the teacher and said, you know, so can you have it in the afternoon? So obviously teacher said, why? She said, no, my mother is working on the Mars mission. That's why. So the teacher, no, please don't disturb your mother. Let her work. It's fine. She can come later. Like that. So nobody even knew. Yeah.
Yeah,
that's what I said. These women are very
family also is, you know.
Absolutely.
But, with time, things have changed. I think this should be taught to the younger generation also, that however big work you do, you have to be grounded.
Yeah.
So that, you know.
Absolutely.
Because it was amazing to read that, in fact, you know. Otherwise, nowadays, it is always a boom, boom everywhere. The moment you do something, before you know it, the world knows about it. So.
Yeah.
it's
yeah, like, that's why I had so many stories which I didn't put in, but like all of the women were like that, all of them.
Wonderful, wonderful. It's wonderful really great to know about it. And thank you so much for working so much on it and letting us know the insights, you know. It is actually overwhelming because we cannot imagine people doing such great work, being so grounded and so happy, being unsung also. Like they were just so patriotic and focused that they just did not bother about anything.
Yes, yes, yes.
So,
yes,
yes. Mini, looking at all this, you know, something more disturbs my mind, telling that even though we are celebrating the rise of a woman, but in spite of all this, unfortunately, India is rated as the rape capital. So, what do you think, in spite of achieving the highest level in all professional fields, the women are still being treated as second-class citizens by, I think, this fundamentally patriarchal system. Don't you agree?
Yeah, of course, absolutely. So, in this particular book also, I have written that there are two Indias. There is a shining India where you know, women can aim for the moon and Mars and really kind of reach high. And then there's the other India where you have female feminicide and all kinds of things. And in fact, I've given a whole list of statistics there. And it's difficult to reconcile that, you know, it's the same country which has both Indias and it's the same country. But I think, what can I really say? It is... when you look at the positive side, it kind of at least, you know, gives you hope. Otherwise, you would be so bowed down by the despair and the negativity that when you read these stories of positivity and stories of optimism and hope, it just makes you believe that, okay, you know, all is not lost. And so that is why in my earlier book also, which dealt with the women of Udayanthika Rai, the unlettered, rural, uneducated women who were sitting on a protest against the Kudankulam nuclear power plant. So I wrote that book in 2013 for more than 5 years in Udayanthika Rai, and nobody knew of them. They were just doing their own kind of protest every day, coming every day, sitting for 6 hours on a fast in to protest because you have a nuclear power plant in their backyard without them ever being asked anything about it, you know. Forget permission, even being asked, what are your views? So they said, you're the first person in all these years who has come and asked us how we feel about a nuclear power plant in your backyard. And we would like to tell you, and so I have recorded their stories in that book, Ant in the Year of the Elephant, about how they said that all the people in the government who say that this plant is safe, come and build a house here, no? Come and stay here. Then we'll see how safe you are. So I would ask them, you know, always that you are just you're a bunch of very determined and dedicated, focused women. But that is the state. It's the Indian state. How are you, you know, sort of fighting against it? So that's where the title of the book comes in. They said, if an ant goes into the ear of an elephant, it can drive the elephant mad.
Yes.
So we are the ants. That's how I came. And their stories were equally, inspiring and all. Just that people don't know about them and they're not lettered, but they were equally brave and equally courageous.
Very nice, very nice. Truly inspiring, truly inspiring. Because writing stories is one thing, but writing something which inspires lives, you know, is a great job that you're doing, Mini. Of all the questions, Mini, I would like to know from you that... you yourself are a woman working in so many fields. You're working as a journalist, a filmmaker, author. So there is no dearth of challenges and speed breakers for you. And still, I see a line of upcoming projects and books and films with you. So how do you manage all that with you? I mean, doesn't it affect your mind anytime? Doesn't it stop you from thinking further? Or how does it just go about? It's going to be a real good takeaway for all the listeners and the students.
Yeah, that's an interesting question. To be honest, I have worked in organizations all my life. It's only the last 10, 11 years that I've been a freelancer and I've been writing books and all. But before that, I was with Times of India. I started my career with Times of India and then India Today and then Business India Television and Star Plus. So fortunately, in media, we have the reverse thing. There are more women than men. Actually speaking, in media, I had women bosses all the time. I had women bosses except for Times of India. And to be honest and fair, I don't think I faced any gender disparity other than the fact that when the Ayodhya demolition was happening in 1992, December 6th, that I was not allowed to go. I mean, I was actually told by my female boss that I think it's best that you stay here. You cover the other areas. So I covered the Bombay riots. Because that they anticipated that it would get difficult and it did. But other than that, I don't think I have faced gender disparity ever. It's not been there. What is difficult is that when you are a freelance, as long as you are working for an organization, it's fine. You carve your own kind of way. I was very lucky. I loved my work. I thoroughly enjoyed every bit of the work that I did everywhere. So that was like really good. I don't think very many people can say that. And then as a freelancer, of course, it becomes, because otherwise I always hear people grumbling, I wish I couldn't go to my job, I wish I didn't have to go, but I never felt like that. We traveled length and breadth of the country, making documentaries, doing stories, all of that was fine. When you're a freelancer, the challenges come up because then, of course, you're trying to support yourself also. And then the topics that I choose are not very commercial friendly. They're all mostly rural India. And dealing with injustice and social injustice and stuff like that. So that can be a little lonely. Writing a book is the most loneliest task ever, because once you finish all your primary interviews and everything, then it's you and your laptop and the cursor is just blinking, blinking, blinking. And one whole day, nothing is written, one para at the end, and you feel, I've lost it. I don't know how to do. But you persevere because you have empirical evidence in the past. You've been able to get over it. So now also you will get over a block or whatever. So I think those are all skill sets which you learn on the job and then you try and kind of, strengthen them. But as far as discrimination, I don't think I ever faced any discrimination. Maybe I was lucky. In media, one is lucky. Media mein nahi hai. You have very many more women in media than in other places.
Oh, that's great. That's great. We would like you to share a little bit about your filmmaking also. We, of course, have known a bit about your book.
Sorry to interrupt, ma'am, but we have left.
Yeah, so we will just hear it out from her. We will stop when she finishes. Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yes.
Yeah, okay. Please tell us. I love making films, actually, because it's a collaborative effort. Your crew is there and you're shining a torch. Through all of my films, I have tried to shine a torch on people who are not known, on people whose issues are not known. So I've taken up, even if it's a small thing like a bunch of girls, tribal, underprivileged girls in Jalna, whose lives were changed because of football. So that's a film I did recently, Field of Dreams it's called. And a football coach and education turned their lives around. So, I pick stories like this and I read the newspaper like very carefully. I look for small stories in unknown areas in this country, not urban India, because enough people do urban India. So I like to do rural India and I pick stories which will be of interest, which will open a different world to another person. So much like the ISRO book or Kudankulam book or my first book, Binayak Sen. So this is really what I'd like to do. I love making films, actually. If I want to ask as a partiality, I would prefer to make films.
But you should
in COVID times. In COVID times, one can't go out and shoot now. So
yeah, true.
That's the thing.
So yeah, that's true. It's a temporary phase rather. So let's hope for a good
ahead. Inshallah. Absolutely. That's a good note to end also.
Yeah.
Better days for all of us.
In fact, thank you so much for all your input.
Thank you.
And I would call Aditi to take it over from us. And
thank you. It's been so nice chatting with you, Geeta. Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
Thank you
so much for this wonderful session. And also thank you, Geeta ma'am, for moderating this session. I feel very delighted. And I feel that I am very blessed to be a part of this session. Also, I extend my gratitude to the publisher, Speaking Tiger. On behalf of Orange City Literature Festival, we sincerely express our gratitude towards your acceptance for the session and knowledge shared with us. Our next session is from 5 p.m. with Maji Menon, History of Desire in India. So please stay with us. Thank you.
Twenty years of existence. Two universities. 23 educational institutes offering 137 courses. Thy Sony Group of Institutions, a vision beyond.